Some are JPEG, some are PowerPoint. I wish they kept it with their own laptop, but
it's okay. You got about 10 minutes.
Okay.
Thank you. More than that.
But, so I'll make an announcement. They can go up there if they want to. So I got all the files?
I think so.
That's all they want me to show, it's just the four.
No, okay. I'll get them.
But thank you. There's a USB key if you want.
What?
If they want to dump it on there.
Who's that?
Oh, if you find them.
Okay. No, we're missing one architect. I revised it. Well, she sent a Dropbox. That's what it was. Yeah, here it is. How do I download this? Is that it?
That's okay. Just take. That was a CCM.
What?
I remember it. Okay, I have it.
You got it?
Yep. Thank you. CCM underscore presentation.
This one?
Seven slides, yep, that's
where
it.
Where do you want it?
I have just a folder on the desktop just called presentations.
Oh!
Houston's
That's
here?
It, yep. Thank you.
That?
Yep.
Okay, so you want to plug this in?
Yep.
So, yours first, right?
Okay.
So, there you go.
Thank you very much.
Success for this institution, I think. We are streaming this live to the internet on YouTube. So there is a remote location available on the Grand Portage for viewing if you prefer to sit out there or if you would like to have a little more room. Let's put it that way. There's a few seats still at the front if anybody wants them. And with that, I would like to say that when we started this process back in the spring, after reaching an agreement with Parks Canada on moving ahead to do the preliminary phases of moving the museum to the lift lock, we started with a stage one request for proposals, and we received 97 proposals from all over the world, with the exclusion of Africa and Antarctica. I don't know how many architecture firms are in Antarctica, but they didn't apply. So that left an amazing group from which we ended up with five firms, I think, who are probably some of the best in the world. Well, no, actually, I know they are some of the best in the world. And I'm very proud of all the work they've done. They've done a tremendous job, and I'm sure all you people are very excited to see it. We've made it a little more interesting format to try and get it into one evening. The format is basically they have a 15-minute presentation, with seven slides. I've limited them to seven slides. Anybody knows architects, one slide is worth 20 minutes, so, seven slides is a lot for 15 minutes for architects. So, and after that, there's a 5-minute question period, and I'll assist with identifying questions, but don't feel bad if you don't get to your question. The architects are going to be standing. We have five locations throughout the museum. There's two in here, and which were given to our international guests, and three outside. And you can definitely talk to the architects after the presentations. I think anybody who signed up was given a support token that they can then put in a box, which indicates
And I think you're going to have a tough time deciding which box to put it in. But so you have a choice of where to put your token. And it's for the best firm or scheme or both, if they're the same. And also there's an opportunity to provide notes. You should also know that the schemes will be online at CCM. And you'll also be able, there'll be a box there, an email address at which you can make further comments if you'd like. So there's lots of opportunity for comments. Don't feel bad if you don't get to all your questions. I think that's sort of the ground rules for now. So 8 to 9 hours
will be available. So with that, hopefully I'll try and keep the schedule here since I've laid down to take schedule for everybody else. So I got 2 minutes.
You planning to get the boards up?
Yes. Thank you, David. It is keeping on track like usual. But yes, we're putting the boards up on the easels,
and each of the firms will have a chance to put their boards up. With that, the first firm is Provencher Roy Noor from Montreal and also Kingston. And I would like to say they have tremendous experience in the museum field. Noor is one of the biggest architecture firms in Canada and has a global practice and is...
There's some tremendous buildings around the world. And there's also...
Provencher Roy has done some of the most amazing museums across Canada, and I think you'll find that they have a tremendous presentation that's really interesting and quite challenging, and a lot to think about. So with that, I'll turn it over to David, I believe.
Thank you very much. This is a great night for architecture in Peterborough, yet another great night. Just to recall that this city has some of the greatest architecture in the country from Ron Tom and Eberhard Zeidler. And we think tonight is another night of experience. It's my great pleasure to have been able to team with Provencher Roy from Montreal. Claude Provencher is here, and Nicolas Demers-Stodard. They have a huge experience in fine art and museum experience. They were named in 2015 by the Royal Architectural Institute of Canada as the architectural firm of the year, and it's certainly well deserved. This is a very sustainable project that you're about to see. We anticipate a zero carbon footprint, and we have drawn on all natural wood construction. So with that, I'm going to let Nicolas go through the design in detail, and I hope that if you have any questions, we have an extensive description of how the mechanical and structural systems of this would work. Thank you.
Thank you, David. If we could go to the next slide.
Essentially, when we first received the brief for the Canadian Canoe Museum, something that struck us was that this institution fulfills three fundamental functions to its identity. The first one is a storage function, and I think you've all seen the giant warehouse just across the parking lot, which houses this precious collection. The second one is the exhibit function. And it's right behind you, and it's an incredible exhibit. And the third one is a collective function, and it's the one we're doing today, right here, right now. And we believe that those three functions needed to be addressed in such a fashion that they could have an equal access to water on the site. So if you can imagine that blue band at the bottom of your screen being the waterway here in Peterborough by the lift lock, we organized each one of these functions in a pavilion perpendicular to the site. A little bit like the farms in the Saint-Laurent that are organized perpendicularly to the St. Lawrence River so that each farmer can have equal access to the water. And so the first one, the one that's further away from me, if you will, is what we call the archive pavilion. It's where we house and store the collection, and also where there is the administrative staff and the volunteers. The central one is the exhibit pavilion, and it has a diversity of spaces that allow the Canadian Canoe Museum to present its artifacts in a variety of ways. And the third one, closest to the lift lock, is the collective pavilion. And this is where you can have events like we have tonight, a restaurant, a bar, the Lift Lock Museum, and also maybe a 300-person wedding or a conference with people coming from out of town. By separating each one of these functions just a little bit, we've been able to weave the waterway and the park together, meaning that now the Canadian Canoe Museum is more connected than it is right now to its fundamental purpose or to its identity, and that is navigating on the water. It's also a means of connecting the city of Peterborough with its heritage, weaving both together, and in the same way weaving its past and future together. We can see here in the full site plan of our proposal how we've decided to cover each one of those pavilions with these shells. These shells face north as they're closed, protecting the exhibits and the art. South as they're closed, protecting the exhibits and the artifacts from direct sunlight, therefore reducing the need for temperature and heat control as we're trying to preserve those items. But they're open to the north, allowing for indirect sunlight to come into the exhibit spaces, meaning that the canoes can be exhibited in light-filled spaces without being damaged. It also means you can go through the museum without having what we call museum syndrome. That means going from white box to white box to white box without ever seeing daylight. And the collective pavilion is facing the Lift Lock. That means that the kitchen, the restaurants, the bar, the Lift Lock Museum, and the public and educational facilities and conference facilities are always facing the landscape or facing that Lift Lock. It's what would happen in the background. We can also see how we've, without encroaching on the waterway, brought the waterway in between those pavilions, allowing the public to have an experience that works both inside and outside with the water. And there's connections, there are pedestrian connections, which allow one to walk across the pavilions there at the back. We've also designed such a way that a full range of exterior activities can continue going on, the ones that are going on right now, if you will, but also we can imagine skating in the winter, and people can stop at the museum and have a bite to eat, or leisure boat activities, and people can stop at the museum and maybe go up to the museum and visit the exhibit if they're just passing by, and so on and so forth. So this is a way of attracting but also keeping people here and interested on this site through the Canadian Canoe Museum program. Next slide, please. And so these are the types of activities we can imagine that could go on and around the museum. And if we want to re-kickstart the economy, we could maybe reinvent the Canoe Museum automobile right down here. Who knows these days? But this is the type of sort of activities we envision happening with this type of scheme. Both, you know, competitions, but maybe a leisurely lover's stroll down the museum that you stop at the cafe, but also people working, fixing canoes, and so on and so forth. This is a view, the top cross-section shows what it would be like for the public to enter the museum from the parking lot. And you can see that this simple shell, this very thin wood structure, allows for a column-free space, which means that the exhibit spaces are fully flexible, they can be redesigned, and the public can have a direct view to the waterfront, but it also means that from the waterfront, you can have a direct view all the way into the museum. And we've created a diversity of spaces, so you can have a great hall for a permanent exhibit, or you can have a smaller space up at the top for a temporary exhibit that might change over time. And there's what we call a black box underneath, which is where you would put your most sensitive artifacts, so they can be in very, very properly controlled conditions. And we've tried to follow that shape of the landscape that is already on site already, and simply deposit this shell on top of it. The view below is a view looking back from the permanent exhibit space by the water, and we can see this incredible canopy just covering the exhibit space and protecting us from that southern light, allowing northern light to come in through a glazed surface. That's looking at the collective shell, so down here would be the restaurant by the waterfront. We can see the relationship between landscape, water, and the exhibit in the museum's program and identity. Next slide, please. David spoke about sustainable design, and he felt that if we could, with one simple gesture and move, achieve that, without getting into very heavy and complex mechanical systems, there would be something analogous to a canoe in terms of design philosophy. And so this diagram does represent how we orient the shells to the south to protect it from direct sunlight, but through geothermal heating, we can maintain the various pavilions' heat loads. And by the way, the various pavilions have various needs, so it's actually good that we separated them in such a way. We can also see how we're collecting rainwater before it goes back into the canal, and that relationship between, again, the landscape and the water and the various functions and pavilions. Next slide. So this is that view that I spoke about. Once you enter the lobby, you can see on the right the temporary exhibit space or play area. And from here, you can see directly down to the waterfront and vice versa. And you can orient yourself very rapidly, very quickly with respect to the entire exhibit. On the left, again, there's that collective shell. And just past those columns is an exterior staircase, which means that people can, yes, drive their car to the museum, park it, and walk into the lobby. But if somebody's taking a jog or taking his or her boat down the water canal, they can also park it there right in front and walk up to the museum. And that relationship between water and landscape, or water and city, we find is very beneficial. And again, that wood roof, that sort of structure that houses the entire exhibit without calling upon heavy columns and heavy systems. Next slide, please. This is the plan of the overall scheme, and on the left you can see there's a lot of storage and offices and volunteer areas, and so that's what we call the archive shell. And in the center there is that exhibit shell with a lobby and a retail space, and then the variety of exhibit spaces below. And on the right, the collective shell, we feel, is maybe one of the most interesting aspects of the project, because it's what allows the community to come back over and over and over again to the museum. And this is where we have the lift lock museum at the very top, with a direct view onto the lift lock. So you always see the lift lock now when you'd be at that museum. And we placed it to make the staff happy right beside a bar. Which we think is an awesome idea, and we met them yesterday and they approved. But a bar with an exterior terrace on the upper part of the landscape, which keeps people coming and going to the museum, and then a whole sort of multi-purpose flex space that can be reconfigured with foldable walls, which means you can have a Lions Club meeting, you can have an educational meeting, and you can have a small conference at the same time, or you can just throw a 300-person wedding and have a ball. And we can do this while the museum is closed, because we divided the museum into three fundamental segments that operate on different needs. This allows for sort of interoperational capacity of the museum, and this shell can help, or this pavilion can help generate revenue also for the museum. So it not only ties into the community, but helps sustain the future of the museum. Next slide. This is our storage pavilion, and our idea was, why put all these canoes into a big box that we're never going to see again? And then that's kind of too bad, because it's an incredible storage. And so to the right is a glazed wall where the public can walk up to the what we call the visible storage pavilion and look at the storage. They might not be able to see every single artifact all the way to the back row, but they can see at least some artifacts placed up front, so they're not just collecting dust, they're also semi-collecting dust, but also demonstrating the full depth of the Canadian Canoe Museum. Next slide. This is a view from the very end of the exhibit pavilion, and we can see we have about a 10-meter high ceiling, so we can arrange artifacts in array of installations. You're connected to the lift lock, you're also connected to the museum, and again, between all the activities that happen on the waterfront and the museum. So if you will, there's a form of reactivating this waterfront in a very civic and public and fun way, and making the exhibit part of that reactivation of the canal. Next slide. And this is maybe the final slide, and we'll leave you on this one. At the left, you can see that visible storage space we talked about, and we see how it would be
reactivated now through what we understand as more than just a museum, but also a form of civic project that helps reorient sort of the future of this site and create more opportunities. And as you can see, the museum can be closed that night, still lit up, while there's an awesome party happening in the collective show. And then, yeah, people are just coming out of the museum and stopping by and having a drink, having dinner. And we're leaving, again, an hour of the landscape, the museum, the city of Peterborough together. That's about it. Thank you very much. Well, as you can see, that was the first of a set a really high threshold for everybody else to follow. So.
Excited. So, with that, is there questions for anybody?
I have a question. What is the water level if it floods every spring? Is that safe, the water level that close to the water edge? Do you know if it floods every waterway floods every spring, if that's the danger of the water level, but it's very beautiful to look at.
It's up at the level. It's at the same level as the edge of the canal.
But when the canal does flood over there,
the canal will
spring. When it floods every spring,
surge up. Our level of this is set at the point where we're not going to be subjected to flooding. We are up off of that surface, there's no question.
I should add that the canal is actually controlled in terms of water levels. I'm sure you can ask that one. So it should be at that level all the time. If it's not, it's something really bad.
Yes, ma'am.
Like the idea of a marina there, but I don't know what the distance is from one side to the other side of the canal. And you're close to the lift lock. What is the safety concern with renting the canoes close to the lift locks and the other lock is down by Mariah?
The intention, first of all, is it's not essentially a canoe rental. It is a demonstration area that's being used to demonstrate and possibly train people in a very small way. You've seen that we've actually widened the canal substantially at this point. We have moved, if you want to go back to that slide, just go back further. Go back to the site plan. There, you'll see that we've moved the water back an extensive period here. There is a major surgery taking place on the canal at this point to allow these kind of events from the workshop that's in between the buildings to bring canoes out. To have a number of areas here where it's possible to make use of canoes that are there, but the intention would be that in many cases we're not with a restaurant that's here. There's a limited amount of activity that's going on.
So you might have to space it, McDonald's, boats going here and there, and the canoes taking up that space. Be so mind that there might be an objective. When that floods in the spring, floods it always overflow. Example again, we should have idea.
Just one question from everybody. So, do we have any other questions?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
I want to congratulate the engineer architects for this concept. It's outstanding. I'm happy to see how you link the new works to the existing waterworks. But just one comment. When you show a plan like that, it would be very helpful to show some, just point existing lift locks. So immediately we can lock into that plan. You see what I'm saying? You show the new stuff, just a little description. So it's easier to focus on the entire overall concept.
That's a good observation.
One last question. Have you maximized the roof for solar energy use? As much as you can get from that.
What we're going to do, part of our scheme, as you've seen, is to build that structure.
Section.
Yeah, if we go back to the cross section.
Go down to the cross.
Is to build this out of structurally insulated panels, and David could probably fill in on them.
So you'll see a pattern that's on the roof here. That effect,
as we curve the shells down, that's where the photovoltaic panels are placed. If you go to the next slide here, you'll see here a pattern that's on the surface. that's the pattern
of photovoltaic panels that are there. And they may be translucent, they may allow some light in, or they may be fully open and allow reflected light in, but there's a number of options that we have with regard to this.
Can you still break that window?
Yes.
Lady in that green?
I'm just wondering, it looks so much, it's evocative of a canoe structure. What material would you be using for the beams and the ribs? Are you going for wood?
Yes, so this is a glue, there's two options. Either heavy timber that's in a laminella structure. We have to have a structure that's going to go from being a wall structure to a roof structure. And it could also be a glue lam structure that with cross purlins. You'll actually see, I've got a book here, an exact example of this that's used at the Fort Erie crossing at Buffalo for the that area. So that's the shape that we're trying to create with the
shell. Could be back of that in the sewer.
Yes, ma'am.
When you're talking about extending, putting the water in, has this been all approved through Parks Canada?
Parks Canada have seen this this scheme. There are, this is a major endeavor that's going to happen on the waterfront. And no question that there still is work to be done in discussing with all of the partners that are going to be here. The City of Peterborough, the Province of Ontario, and the Government of Canada all will have to be partners in making this a success.
Yes,
how is the volume of the museum on compared to the size, volume, whatever?
Sorry, what was the question?
How would the size of the museum pod compared to what's existing here?
The program is approximately, it's shown on these plans, on all the plans, is approximately 80,000 square feet, which is about the current space the museum occupies at the moment is about 110,000. But that includes all the warehouse space and stuff that's not used very efficiently right now. So the exhibit space is slightly larger, the storage space is actually smaller, but we achieve that by putting boats in racks rather than just having them on the floor.
We, our particular design actually reduces the storage space and makes it higher. We devoted some of that area to a more exhibit space in this particular design for the program. But these shells are flexible. They can move around. It's more the concept of the extent of black box space can be increased or decreased in what may be required.
Okay, one last question.
Lady over here.
Lady down here.
Oh. I'm sorry, whatever. You, there's a lady here.
There's.
I was wondering about the amount of light that is getting into the collection storage space.
So, if you're, there's a number of things we would look at. First is the light control. There's a number of patterns of frit that would be on the glass as one option. If you've been to the Opera House in Toronto, you'll see that on its west facing, like they actually have exterior screens that come down. The light, the sunlight in the morning is the only real one that we have concern for here in terms of that short period of time when it comes around. So certainly motorized screens would come down and affect them. But the experience that Provence-Chaillois has had and the examples in a number of European art space and museum space is an ever-increasing amount of natural light that's brought into these spaces. And remember that these canoes are a natural outdoor element. There are elements of this collection that are definitely sensitive, and we have AA rated conservation space in here for temperature and humidity control. But there is other parts of the exhibit which really deserve to have natural exposure in natural light. And I think that that's something that we'll work with the curators and our exhibit team, that's also from Montreal, in finessing that portion of the work.
How much snow frost on the outside?
Thank you. Thank you very much. That's so probably to you. David.
We have a small token of thanks from the Canoe Museum for all the work you guys have done. And so you have your Voyageur sash for the firm and three buttons.
Is this a Kahlua prize?
No. It may be in addition to two.
Just one.
Keeping right on schedule here, I would just like to mention that, just so you know, as part of the competition, all the architects were issued the same set of facts and information in what's called a design brief, which laid out the amount of space we're looking for and the uses and the various requirements. A lot of the stuff you will see on here reflects a business plan and aspirations set out by the museum to become national in scope, to get on water programming, and to become financially self-sustainable. So those elements are reflected in the designs, and I can attest that all of the architects have complied with the programming requirements that we set forth. So with that, the next architect is Con Pedersen Fox. Con Pedersen Fox, or KPF, is from New York. They're a global architectural firm and have done a number of wonderful buildings throughout the world, including the Museum of Modern Art in New York, and as well as more recently the Ritz-Carlton in Toronto. So with that, I will introduce Josh Chaykin, who will take us through their very interesting scheme. Thank you, Josh.
Hello, it's great to be here. Actually, I want to first start off by saying, or asking, if I want the slides to change, I just ask. Oh, Evan, thank you. And then the second thing I
can hear you.
Thank you. Okay.
Better?
Talking to the mic. I spent a lovely afternoon here in Peterborough. It got me thinking that maybe Richard's schedule was designed to immerse us in the community a little bit, since we had a day to spend between yesterday's presentation and this evening's. And the reason I bring this up, I spent the afternoon most of the time at the Silver Bean. I'm not plugging this, but the Silver Bean was great. I really enjoyed it, and they had free Wi-Fi, so I was able to sit and work there in the afternoon and enjoy the river. And it reminded me, and you know, of course it would, of the site for this museum, which is also it's a lovely site, it's a wonderful site. And my, you know, visceral memories of it are of a very a serene site. The lift lock is a sort of an important component of that site. When we were here a couple of months ago, there was something very calming about the pace of the lift lock itself, every now and then changing positions. And you know, we felt, and I think the other architects share this, that the museum really wants to take advantage of that and make the most of that site. So on with the presentation. So, I mean, one reason why I began with that is because in our proposal, we were paying attention to the site in a particular way. The image here is of a waterfront settlement. This happens to be in Nova Scotia, but this was an idea, not this particular settlement, but it could be any waterfront settlement. As we were searching for an identity for the museum, as another approach, we thought the idea of a waterfront settlement was a good starting point. Waterfront settlement could be have an iconic identity. So this was the idea. This is, you know, one depiction of that image. So next slide, please. So just jumping right into our scheme, and then I'll go back and talk about it a little bit. This is a view of our project, and this view is from across the canal. Of course, you can see the lift.
So the identity of the project is its presence on the canal.
What we were trying to achieve with this design was a sort of a simplified, if you will, elegant version of a waterfront settlement. You see the series of simple volumes. They're clad in wood, and at the bottom there is a varying level here. I should use we've introduced glazed openings along the waterfront. So this portion of the museum has a direct relationship to the waterfront, and the volumes form a kind of picturesque composition. So keep this in mind as we go through. Now, the other part of this that we were considering was its relationship to the lift lock itself, the scalar relationship. So for us in this design, we wanted a building, a massing that was very sympathetic with the lift lock, that still had a distinct personality but was seeking a balance between having an iconic image and at the same time something that felt very comfortable with the site and didn't try and change it so much. So we were going for a somewhat subtle approach to how we intervene on the site. Next slide, please. So this slide describes our approach to the site. The major feature of the site is the canal with its gentle bend, the lift lock right here. And we discern two primary parts of the museum program, that there is an inward looking part, and in our proposal we've chosen to think of both the museum exhibit space as well as the storage space as being wanting to be more inward looking. Yes, one could carefully bring light in, but carefully. By making it this part more inward looking, we're controlling that some more. Then there is the outward looking part of the program, all the parts of the museum program that for the most part end up being these great amenities that have been conceived that were part of the brief. So they include the multi-purpose space, the restaurant, the bar, the cafe, all of those elements. So we've broken the program into those two parts. We've pushed the outward-looking part towards the waterfront, and the inward-looking part we've embedded back into the site, and they are then separated by an axis here, which you'll see becomes kind of an internal street for the project. One other, maybe a couple of other points, just dwelling on this diagram for just a minute more. The site is a sloping site, as it is right now. As you know, where the visitor center is, you drop off, you enter on an upper level, and then there's a lower level. So it's very easily a full floor difference between the entry level and the lower level. Again, we were trying to work with the contours of the site. This was in consideration to practicality, to expense to some extent, to a large extent. So we were looking for a way to use the contours of the site in a practical way. And you'll see in some of the images that we're suggesting that the entry level here, in some ways, like, and I don't want you to really associate our design with the existing visitor center, but you do enter on an upper level here. This is approximately where the drop-off is. From this drop-off point here, you will have views of the lift lock as you enter the museum. And then you will descend in a couple of possible ways down to the exhibit space. So let's go to the next slide. So here's an overview of the project. You can see the different components. The axis that was shown on that diagram is right here. The drop-off is here. So the drop-off is on an upper level here. You're entering the museum on this upper level. The exhibit space and the storage space are, you could say, efficiently packed into these rectangular volumes here. And these two volumes we're suggesting would have a green roof on them to make them feel more part of the landscape. And then on the other side of that internal street here are the pavilions that comprise the amenities for the museum. And they all have, there are terraces that surround these different amenities. On the level, more or less on the level of the canal, the ground does slope down a little bit, so it's not exactly on canal level. Another element that was part of the brief that we've incorporated into how we've embraced the site is a boathouse and the canoe lay-by. These were for the functions that that Dave was just describing. So for the canoe activities that the museum might be sponsoring and organizing, they would occur in this little half round here, and then there are some docking spaces here for visitors. So this is out in the landscape. It's engaged by the building through this axial connection. And otherwise, these landscape spaces here could be used for events on either the southern face here, well, where it will get quite a bit of sun, and along the canal front here, where the restaurant and the bar are located. Next slide. This is a view of the entry at the drop-off. So we've chosen to strategically introduce special elements in the museum so that
the entire structure is not an expressive structure. Some parts are quieter than others. So we've focused instead on, for instance, this axis here, which is an important element of the museum. It's how you enter in the end here, so again, drop off here,
enter in the end here, and this axial element here is the one part that maybe has the most kind of canoe-like reference to it. It shares some of the craft and the fabric and the scale. The materiality is a mixture. It's a little different. It's a building. It's architecture. It has wood, as you can see, some exterior grade wood for the cladding as well as the underside. But to keep this structure light and to make it feel elegant, we introduced a metal structure here. There would be more metal structure above. Flanking the entry here is one of the pavilions that line the waterfront. This particular pavilion here has a cafe on the upper level that opens onto an upper terrace here. Next slide, please. Once inside the museum, this is one of the ways maybe the primary route to progress from the upper entry level down to the lower level where most of the museum program is located. So from this upper level here, you have a view of the landscape beyond. At the end of this axis, there's the boathouse at the end here. The stairs are flanked by a glass elevator here. And to our right, this enclosure is enclosing the exhibit space itself. And it is clad in a combination of wood, of cedar cladding, and precast concrete, so that the concrete cladding makes some reference to the left lock material. Next slide. And this is a view now from the lower level, this is the exhibit level. We're actually looking at the end pavilion that houses the multi-purpose room. It is surrounded by pre-function space. This is the space that people break out into before and after the events. In fact, the events often also transpire within these spaces, and there would be doors located along here to open on to the landscape. Again, this is that primary axial canopy roof element that organizes the whole scheme. So to one side are the part of the program that opens onto the canal, and on the other side is the part of the program that is more embedded into the landscape, into the hillside. And next slide. So this is, again, a view now looking in the other direction,
a waterfront view. And again, the intention is that this is an identity view for the museum. This village or waterfront settlement of these pavilions The one here is the one.
The one that's most glazed. Otherwise, the others are primarily clad in wood with the glazing just down at the bottom to open up nice views of the landscape. And along the end here are the
administrative offices that have a terrace above them on the upper level here. This terrace is then, you can see, the company. The
canopy element that forms the drop-off and entry. And I think that may be the last of the slides. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Josh. So I just open the floor to questions for 5 minutes. So is there any questions from the floor? Gentleman there?
Could you discuss this, the relative square footage?
The question was discussing the relative square footage. We have met the square footage of the brief. The overall size of this museum is about 80,000 square feet. So it meets the program.
Okay. Question on use of solar energy. Have you given any consideration to that in your
not as far as photovoltaic. That's of course an option or a possibility. In terms of the orientation of the building and how it would perform. In terms of its heat loads, heating and cooling, those were considered in our design development.
Yes?
You mentioned that there was some cladding in wood and some glass. I'm wondering why that choice was made or what you were hoping to achieve with that.
Yeah. I think the primary cladding, as you can say, is wood and glass. The question is why did we pick this particular palette? I think we felt that the wood was one appropriate way, kind of a crossover of a material which is both common to architecture and, of course, to canoe and craft building. And, of course, in this case, we would lean towards its treatment being somewhat more architectural, but still referencing the canoe craft. Glazing is just naturally what where you would want to have good views. So we focused the glazing where the best views were, and even expressively, you could say that the most important views on the project, even though the whole waterfront is wonderful, the most important views we think are towards the lift lock. So this both functionally offers more views of the lift lock, excuse me, and it also even expresses the idea that this corner, in real estate terms, that's 100% corner. That's where you put the dollar signs, and it seems like maybe this will be common to many of the approaches. And this is where you want to be to have your dinner, your drinks, your cocktails. This is a great place to, even as it is now, if you just visit the site. You want to sit at a picnic table here and enjoy the afternoon.
It looks as if you have 7 distinct interlocking buildings there. Could you explain from left to right what the buildings represent?
Yes, certainly. So, I'm going to have to get away from this a little bit too, and I'll try and speak up a little easier. So, primarily, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Pavilions that are pulled out towards the waterfront. These three here, 1, 2, 3, comprise the multifunction. So one could have expressed that as just a single building. We felt that was going to be too big. We wanted to break the scale down. So we broke that one part of the program down into 3 volumes and expressed that with the height of the window head going up and down. The next one here, this one has the lift lock. There's a special museum within the program for the lift lock. It replaces what's in the current visitor center. That is here, and there's a special frame window. It looks towards the lift lock. And then otherwise, at the bottom here are where stairs come down, and apologies for not having all the plans here.
There were some limitations. This is where the stairs came down. And then finally, this last pavilion here has the restaurant and the bar on the lower level. And on the upper level, there's a cafe that's set back. And this cafe both looks out on the canal and also opens onto the terrace here.
Any questions?
Is there a convention center portion? Is that the cafe portion? Where's the convention center?
The multi-purpose room, I guess, is another name for it, the convention center. So that's these three, one, two, three here. And actually, I'm sorry, you said seven. And seven is, there are seven. I just mentioned the first one. But this one here, this lower one, is where the administrative wing is.
And what's the far left?
And at the far left, that's actually pushed back further in space, and that's where the storage facility is. So that one doesn't engage the waterfront in the same way.
Mr. Chairperson.
No, you already asked one. Let's see if there's somebody else first. Yeah, okay. That's okay. Yes, yes.
The exhibit space, is that also in the same storage building?
Is
the storage
and
the exhibit spaces,
are they
the same?
Can we go back to the aerial view? So the exhibit space is under this large rectangular volume here. That's our exhibit with the transition here. This is the storage here. And so the storage moves directly in to the exhibit space. There's also a way for visitors to have a peek into the storage without actually entering the storage.
So for those who may not have heard, the question was, are the exhibit space and the storage space the same? So it's not. There's somebody else with that here. Go ahead.
Was there a slide that showed what the exhibit space was like?
There was not in this presentation. There was not. So the question is, was there a slide that shows the exhibit space? And the answer is no. There wasn't. There wasn't a slide. You didn't miss that. And that was our conscious choice. To some extent, we decided that the exhibit space was actually going to be developed by an exhibit designer, which is one approach that the museum might take. And we chose to keep that as flexible as possible. There is a common-free space. The access to that exhibit space is part of our plan. How that exhibit space is actually laid out would be something that would be developed, you know, in the next phase of the design.
I was just thinking about the light question. Like, would there be, like the other presentation they were talking about natural light?
Yes.
Would you plan to have natural light in the exhibit space?
So the question is, would we plan to have natural light in the exhibit space? And we are suggesting some controlled natural light in the exhibit space along this edge here at the galleria that connects from this axis to the storage facility. That would be one place where we would allow natural light to come in. However, in terms of being an integral part of the exhibit space.
Okay, one last question. This gentleman here.
Just curious, you have this little perky bit down here on the left-hand side where boats can run. I'm just curious why it wasn't slid up in front of the building as opposed to being down at this corner of the site. Is there any rationale behind that?
Okay, so the question is with regards to the boathouse and the canal, the canoe basin, why is it not closer to the museum?
And that's a good question. And our thinking there was to pull it away to engage more of the site. I think if we had pulled it closer, it would have left a little less room, maybe for a larger outdoor event. And we liked the idea of pulling this axis that is tying the whole site together to sort of pull it across and engage the waterfront at this end.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So that that's Josh Chaikin from Confidence and Fox in New York, and we have three more schemes to come, and I just want to express our appreciation to Josh and his team for putting this together and coming up to Peterborough to work with us. So, where's your sash and pins for your team. So, next, we have 546. I can't remember the entire number, so I call him 546 for short. So, I'm sure Joanna can let you know what the whole number is and where it came from. That was an interesting story in itself. So we will basically... The 546 is an up-and-coming architectural firm from Winnipeg. As you can see, they're working on the young and more fun side of things, I think.
Upcoming.
So, compared to some of the other guys, sorry about the other architects in the back there. More seasoned, I don't know what the word is. I can say that since I'm more seasoned. They'll be basically presenting their work. They've done some really interesting work and been held up in a lot of the architectural magazines for some of the more creative stuff that they've done in Winnipeg. And I know they're going to be going on to success and success in the future, and I hope you welcome 546, Joanne.
Sasha, and if you don't vote for our building, I hope you vote for him for the best hair.
For the best shoes.
Thank you.
Before we introduce, we are teamed up with Mariana Tashima from Toronto, who are famous for a number of museums that they've done, so they bring that seasoning that Richard's talking about.
We have been so enriched by the stories of the Canoe and the stories through Jeremy and Carolyn and Richard here at the museum, and by everybody that we've met who's been working on canoes and telling us about the amazing sort of object that the canoe is, and it's really truly inspired us throughout the design process, and we feel incredibly fortunate to be here with you all tonight. So I'm going to start by showing you the image of what we picture to be the most important part of the museum, really, is to try to bring a site to its natural setting. So bringing back from that blue grass and manicured site to something where we can imagine the canoe first appeared, where we can portage it across sections of land and bring it back into water. And what we imagine is putting a birch grove and trembling aspen between the parking lot and when you first enter the museum. And as you sort of peer through the trees, you get to start to see the shimmer of the building itself, catching the sunlight. And then hearing those leaves, the trembling aspen around you, as you find your way to the end of the boardwalk. And then you can take the boardwalk and be surrounded by those trees, and the building starts to appear around you as you get closer to it. And that's really what allows you to leave the city behind. It gets your mindset back into something where you can feel like you can really pick up the canoe and be surrounded by what's the best part of Canada, the beautiful nature.
I guess I'll take over on this slide. So in order to do that, we've done a couple of things that are fairly simple. We're hoping the museum is going to be extremely successful and therefore need a lot of parking, and that's what the city of Peterborough is telling us. So it's sort of doubling up the capacity of parking. As you see, the current parking is right there on the site, and this is the locks right here. The current exhibition, or the current lift lock pavilion is somewhere there. So what we try to do is we try to create a landscape Johannes honest talked about, get a building to embrace you as you come across the boardwalk, but also create another backdrop to the building on the other side of the canal. So what it does create a frame, as you can see here on these diagrams, it creates a little clearing in the forest that has the trees on either side, it has a creek or a canal down the middle and an outcropping on which the museum sits. The museum is sort of a tent-like place that is sitting light and low on the landscape, right in the middle of the trees.
And as you get into that cut, that's really the only thing that we'll focus our sort of financial efforts into. It actually, the landscape drops down, and so without entering the museum, you can either take the boardwalk that takes you on a bridge to the museum, or you can kind of descend with the landscape down into the site without actually entering the museum. And we think this is one of the ways that the museum will really add another amenity to the city of Peterborough. When there's a place that people can either toboggan or they can come and hang out while you have their skates on from the canal, they can come and grab hot chocolate in the wintertime, or they can simply just be in another place that really is about creating a place that is owned and felt like it's your place.
And the, I think we'll move to the next slide here. So what you're seeing here is the museum is on the chair of two levels, and that's the cut through the building that you can actually go over the building and then under the building and emerge on the other side, which is where the very canal opens up for you. On the second floor, it's basically divided into two sections. On your right-hand side is the museum proper. On your left-hand side are the hospitality items, like the restaurant and the bar and the pastry kiosk and a large banquet room. So this room can be approved upon according to Richard, so we're going to try to do that. And then by putting it closest to the lift box, we're creating an opportunity for a large deck on the second floor that then views over or looks over the lift box right in this corner. And on the lower floor, right underneath the exhibition space, is where our museum canoe storage is. It's hidden, it's a gem. Today, you have to make a special effort to go see it, and that's one of the things we're trying to make. We've created a number of glimpses where you can see what the storage richness is, and we're all mesmerized by the sheer collection and the richness of that collection. And then the on the side facing the canal, then facing this public room, that is the outcropping on the canal between the building and the canal, are the education rooms and the workshops. So the those activities can be exposed to all of you, burgers, I guess is what they're called. And on the other side, underneath the function space, is the offices for the staff and the curatorial. We also tucked in a little pond, which is where you can actually train and learn how to get into canoe and out of canoe. And trust me, I've tried that. Being an immigrant to Canada about 20 years ago, I tried getting into canoe and still learning how to do that. And then the little kiosk where you can actually rent canoes and skates and wooden chairs and so on.
And now you're just standing in the entryway, so now you're looking back towards that entryway that actually is all around you. And we can see also that the restaurant itself can spill on to the west side so that it actually captures the western sun. So you can have a really intimate setting in this birch grove on the parking lot side without seeing the parking lot. And then on the other side, you have an expansive view towards the canal, towards that other and now we can arrive to the other side of the museum. And what we have is sort of a shimmering mesh over the box of the actual canoe building. And what it is almost opaque when the light hits it, but then it becomes completely transparent when it's lit from within. And also, the way that the mesh works is that when we have the auto colors, for example, it'll absorb some of that color and reflect it. Or when there's a frost in the air, it actually collects that snow on it. And so it really becomes part of the landscape throughout the season. It transforms itself to be part of it. And we have the postcard moment towards the lift lock, so it's lying low and making sure that we respect the magnificence of the lift lock itself. From the other side, the main building facade is the trees. It's the tree grove that you will encounter. That's almost like a filter that you walk through in order to prepare yourself for the experience of seeing the canoes.
So what happens, right above the top, you're seeing the elevation of the facade as seen from the canal. And you can see a ramp that connects you up between the two levels. And it's operational to get the canoes from one level to another, but also allows us to show proof canoes to everybody who visits the site. One of the things that was crucially important for us was the experience of this museum and actually becoming a place that belongs to you, the citizens of Peterborough. That's a better way of saying it. And it was the idea that you're welcome there, whether you're willing to go into the museum or not, but you're welcome there and it becomes your living room. And the being Canadians, we have great summers, we have great shoulder seasons, but we also have great winters. So in the summertime, we can see people hanging around underneath the building and around the building and using that as a place to together experience this amazing heritage that we have and at the same time embrace the history of the locks and the canal. But on the inside, what we're trying to do, and what we're trying to do right along the landscape, is build an amphitheater, which is a place that doubles up as a presentation place, but it also doubles up, also becomes the place where you can ascend up to the second floor. And that is our hope, becomes your living room on the water. And that's what you're seeing here with obviously interpretive material and so on.
And there's a lot of little perches and overlooks that then enriches that experience that you get inside with the two levels overlooking one another. And then also with the cafe being on the ground towards the canal, you're able to just dip in there to when you're skating outside or tobogganing outside to get that hot cup of coffee on a cold winter night. And then lastly, when we talked about that shimmering mesh sinuous form of the roof, you can see now that at nighttime it becomes translucent, transparent. And the canoes that are over the interior ramp become completely visible from the outside. And it really transforms and animates that face of the building. So it becomes that picture moment and really draws you towards it, draws you in. It's like having a candlelight on a winter night when you hear it in somebody's window. So again, that's the living room, and we're really, really, really excited to show you. Sean, Brian? Then what our plan is on the inside is around the exhibition space to actually have a similar mesh, but it's more of a scrim, that it's around the canoes, and as we lift it on, and it's taught to the ceiling that flutters just a little bit if we want. You can actually project on it. So if you're in the exhibition space, you can actually surround yourself with a starry sky, or you can surround yourself with the boreal forest up north. And then when the lights are on behind, you can also then expose the canoes that are in the storage space. So it really allows a very efficient, economical way for us to animate and change and allow the museum collection to really live. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for that. It's very interesting to include a demonstration of exhibits, so that's great. So, questions? Anybody has questions on this particular scheme? Yes?
Yes, you talked about the canoe and its collection, and you mentioned the lift lock, but part of this is supposed to tell the story of the lift lock. Where are you doing that?
Perfect. Do you mind switching? Actually, I'm going to show it here, actually. I'll try to. Oh, I see. So the question was the lift lock. How do we actually embrace and celebrate the lift lock presence on the site and so on with the museum? Because we've talked a lot about the museum itself, but not about the lift lock. So the I think we can use this slide. We'll try to explain it. So
try to get away from here. So what you're seeing here is seeing the boardwalk that comes into the building. That's where the building pinches together. It's fairly tight. And that gets you directly to the glass, which is where these people that are shown as black silhouettes are. And that provides a direct view to the lift lock. So our intentions are to show the information about the lift lock 21, which is right there in front of us, on glass, so you can actually see through and understand what you're looking at. And then
you take the stair down those big bleachers that we saw an image of. And on the main landing there, you actually have some of the items, for example, the steam engine that's part of the collection. So some of the physical items would be sitting there. So in a way, it's an interpretive path that takes you down towards the grounds when you then can go from there and leads you towards the lift locks for your visit. So we were thinking about it in sort of two parts, and more of a journey down onto the site.
And then you emerge on the ground floor, which you're on the outcropping, if you wish, or I want to call it beach, but Johanna doesn't like me to. And then from there, you see the rest of the lift lock itself. So there's a, it's a tripartite journey to see it.
I think I did that.
Can you talk a little bit more about this mesh in terms of heat loss, in terms of its ability to last a long time? What's the life expectancy? How often does it have to change? And most importantly, where is it successfully being used?
Okay, so the question is about the mesh and how it's maintained and what it actually is really. And so it's a material that comes more in sheets, and there's various sort of thicknesses of it. It's stainless steel, it can be just pressure washed, and it's almost like a canvas that we've thrown on top of a box, and then it's lifted up at locations. So what it does is gives you a sense of doubled light. So it gives you a shadow and light pattern that's ever-changing and really animates that of the decks and all of the spaces around you and the windows behind that. So it actually provides a significant amount of shade and actually gives you relief from the sun when you want it. It's used all over the place in the world. I would think one place that comes to mind would be New York Canoe Museum. Do you have other examples?
Copenhagen,
Copenhagen. It's used in various places, and then there's another structure underneath that allows it to be sort of lifted. It's almost, like I said yesterday in my presentation, not sure if I was right, but it's like a skirt lifted up in a couple of spots where you enter the building.
Mandate the inclusion of a commercial enterprise, I mean, such as a restaurant, bar, or banquet facilities?
Yes, it did.
And if so, why?
It's a good question, but part of what happens in museums, part of the business side of the museum is you have to be, in this day and age, you have to be self-sustaining, you have to generate revenues to allow you to achieve the objectives you want to do in the museum, one of which is taking care of the artifacts you have. But one of the things is right at the moment, if you come to this museum, you might spend 60 or 90 minutes here looking at the exhibits and the artifacts, and then you're kind of, what next? Okay, so to bring people from the GTA, bring people from further afield than the Peterborough region, we need to create an attraction, an event, some excitement. You come here and you want to spend half a day here. People generally aren't going to travel very far unless they can spend at least half a day. So by combining ourselves with the lift lock, with our artifacts, and then adding some other things on there, a gift shop, a cafe, or a restaurant, these sort of things create the ability for more people to come, more interest to come. It becomes more of a location. And perhaps people would come to the location just to have a bite of lunch, because it's a great view of the lift lock, it's on the water. And then they might decide to come back another day, they might stay for a little bit in the museum, or they might say, you know what, that was a great idea, next time the grandkids come, I'm going to take them over there. So, or my relatives from Europe or wherever. So it's a way of engaging with the community, and it's a way of creating some income and revenue for the museum. So that's really the reason that's incorporated in there. And I think if you go to most museums nowadays, they all incorporate some level of food service to varying degrees. And I, exactly how much still has to be worked out in terms of business plans, because there's versions that are more food service and versions that are less, but we don't know. Yes, ma'am?
Can I ask a general question? Sure. Why were these architects limited to 80,000 square feet?
Again, that's a program that we worked out with staff here.
as to what we thought the program was. Otherwise, the question was, why are they limited to 80,000 feet? And the question is if you just gave the architects free license and let them do kind of whatever, you kind of end up with schemes all over the place, and it's very hard to compare them. Right, so we set out what we thought is the proper program. We did ask them to comment on it, and most of them, I think, seemed to think it was okay. They didn't say anything, so even that, they just don't want to say anything. So I think that was really to try and keep compare apples to apples on a budget basis, right? Because if one scheme's 80,000 feet, and another scheme's 100,000 feet, another scheme's 60,000 feet, there are completely different budgets, and as well as being completely different functionality.
Just I see with some of these displays and exhibits here, that they have used more of the land.
It is. Whether you're on one level or two levels makes a difference, and whether you're pavilions or one building, or a building that's got an entry in it, or your skirt's lifted up, these are all differences that is part of what makes a good scheme, and that scheme, and that's why everybody's here. We're trying to give their ideas input.
Is 80,000 square feet sufficient space for the storage?
Yes, it is.
Thank you.
Ma'am, Luke.
Question for the museum also.
Sorry. I was going to have you. You guys questions. You came over a little bit.
Why did you decide to be located on the canal as opposed to Little Lake? I assume it's the lift block.
Yes, it is next door to the lift block in agreement with Parks Canada. That is the site that the museum's been working on the last couple of years. And it was elected as the best museum. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, cost. Could we get the estimated construction cost? Each proposal.
We have sent all the schemes to a third-party quantity surveyor who is preparing what they call Class D or very outlined budgets for each of the schemes. And the committee will be able to compare those schemes when we're looking at the decisions and then making our recommendation to the board. Part of that analysis will include costs from a third-party quantity surveyor.
Good. Thank you.
So,
yes.
In listening to all the presentations, I keep in the back of my mind the design of Richard Burwell Rogers came up in 1896 and was tasked with building the lift block. Something bold, something innovative, something daring, brand new materials, trying something that had never been tried on that scale anywhere in the world. When I evaluate all of these proposals, and you know there's more coming, what I'm looking for is something that captures the spirit of what Rogers came up with at that world-class engineering piece of technology. That really is world-class. So what we want to all the architects is something that reflects what R.B. Rogers did in designing a world-class, innovative, bold, daring piece of engineering. I won't say what happened to his career after he designed it. That's a story you can hear about at the lift lock. That's what I want to see on the site. It captures and reflects what he did and what was accomplished on that spot.
And we won't tell the architects what happened, so we won't scare them off, because if they win, they'll be very worried. But I think everybody here agrees with that, and that's why we've gone to the effort of trying to recruit some of the best architects in the world to produce that really groundbreaking scheme that is appropriate for the lift lock and for this museum. So any other questions for Sasha and Joanne?
The first question that was asked.
Oh, you want to answer?
Yeah,
thank you.
I'm not sure if we would trade our careers. We might if we were a win of the competition, but that's a bit of a conversation for later or a glass of wine.
I wanted to speak briefly about the question that came from here, why including the elements that are not museum, directly museum related.
And when we received what they call a building program, so the function that we needed to fit into the building, one of the things that was obvious to us, and I think that demonstrated the leadership of the museum, is that having all those functions in a building like this allows it to become a special destination, not for all of us that come to Peterborough want to see this amazing collection, but for all of you. And then the site and the functioning spaces and the restaurant and the cafe, we're hoping they're just gonna get worn and torn by you guys visiting and revisiting this place. And that's why it is sort of, our scheme is created around
those places. So you can actually, Richard probably doesn't want to hear that, but you can visit this museum time after time again and not see the museum itself. Maybe find a hot chocolate or something like that, but certainly not having to engage with the museum itself. And that's how it becomes part of the collective memory. I'm not sure that it reaches the heights of the engineering and like some bravado and hubris that the lock does. But it's the hope that you guys can actually treat it as your own. And if it belongs to you truly, then it's going to belong to the rest of the world. And that's how we are approaching it. Let's see.
I'll just let Sasha answer that question. So, in any case, I think, any more questions? One more? No? Okay. So, basically, I would like to say thank you very much to Sasha and Johanna for coming here and all the work they've done and the beautiful work they've produced and shown to us this evening. And I should mention their partners, Oriana Tashima from Toronto, who have very significant and long-standing abilities, the sage people in these hands over there in the corner on the side there. So, thank you very much. Some of their work, for those who've been to Ireland, the Giant's Causeway Visitor Center, as well as they are currently, I think was the Grand Egyptian Museum in Cairo, which is a new museum for the pyramids. So that's a fairly significant commission. As well as the Palestinian Museum, is that correct, Palestinian Museum, which is just near completion, I think. Is that correct? Yeah. So, with no more said, we have Shafu and Rosen.
It is the tallest. So the vertical line represents the vertical lock, and how do we make something which in plan is a mouse into the elephant, and how do we retain that? So the building is predominantly flat. It is the horizontal dimension. It's a landscape project. It is about touching the activities of the landscape, touching the land. And it's about this juxtaposition of the vertical dimension against the horizontal dimension. And it is really, at the end of the day, the reason that the museum has moved from Monaghan Road to the site It's about connection to the land, it's about connection to the water. It's how do you make a building that is completely takes opportunity of this condition and really pushes it to the edge. So, next. So we're effectively using a classic modernist example of coined by Mies van der Rohe. It's about the plinth and tower. It's effectively the horizontal element that you see there is the horizontal plinth. That's the vertical dimension. And effectively, that is the element that actually connects to the street life, to the urban life. It brings people in, it brings people out. It really activates that whole horizontal landscape. And that is how we see our proposal for the new museum. And as you can see in the other element, which is that swirly thing, that's the ramp of the museum that brings you up to the highest portion and also back down. And that expression of the physical movement is precisely what we want to retain in the Peterborough lot. That stoic nature of verticality juxtaposed against the horizontality of nature and its activities. Next. So, how do we relate the two? It's not necessarily two diametrically opposed conditions. We wanted to kind of almost create a story, like a head and a tail. And we like this image because we call it the yellow brick road. This is the Wizard of Oz. Effectively, the building is the yellow brick line, which actually moves along this edge. It's the roof line that leads to the wizard's castle, which is Peterborough Lot. It's actually this kind of story, this journey. It's about walking, it's about engaging the landscape, it's about the path, it's about connecting, and its destination is Peterborough Lot. And the two together coincide to form something far larger, but yet at the same time, they have these unique individual identities, each working differently. So that condition of this horizontal juxtaposed against the vertical, you can completely see from the interior view looking out. In fact, this kind of window, this horizontal window, is incapable of actually capturing the full height of Peterborough Lock. It just doesn't fit. It's so high. And in fact, and it's really just, how do we actually architect this illusionist? How do we actually push this condition? Along this front edge, which is kind of a layered program, along the back side here, up against that side, within the kind of a buried condition, is the archive and the collection, which is kind of protected from everything else. And in the front side, we have the beginning of the gallery, the workshops, the cafe, the entrance, the dining, the multi-purpose, the wedding chapel, and the edible landscape. All of which creates a continuous filmic scene of activities which engages as a layer, looking out onto the activity, out onto the water, and out onto the Peterborough Lock that does not fit inside the museum window. Next. And a museum that is sited here, on the specific site, is not about one door, it has two doors. We like the canoe not because it's a nice boat. It's a beautiful boat. But what is significant about the canoe, it's actually the first amphibious all-terrain vehicle. It is the closest thing that we know of in our lifetime is James Bond's car, though this is free, and it's Spot and Love You, one that zooms off the dock and becomes a submarine. And that is what the canoe is. The only way you can actually explore the landscape is because it's so finely tuned. Then you pick it up and walk across land and then put it back in the water. That's why it's amphibious. And it's about this connection between land and water that we want to try to capture within the activities of the building. So this is the entrance during the winter, not from the summer, summer's from the other side by far. In the winter, ice skating people will come here and you enter from the front. And then from this front, you can effectively see this kind of filmic facade, and that becomes the window into this, all these activities that the museum will actually house. And that portion on the front is free, so everybody will come and like do stuff. Next. So here you actually see this condition of the amphibious all-terrain vehicle. On the landscape side, there is the museum as it wiggles. People come by car, and then the wiggles actually move out into the landscape, the kind of exhibit, this part of the exhibition, the workshops, the cafe, the entrance,
the restaurant, the meeting, and the wedding chapel, all of which kind of faces out into the space between water and land, and you create this step right there. That's effectively how you actually capture the museum using this notion of the canoe. Go back. And then, now that the museum has taken a place within the site, can we actually invert it? Is it possible that when we void something out and place something there, can we bring something back? And that we see in this roof, which is connected in the, into the ground.
Here. Thank you. Let me just step into your residual energy here. happy fall equinox, actually, everyone. It's my favorite time of year, so I'm glad to be here today of all days. So I'm going to talk a little bit about our landscape strategy. So I'm a landscape architect. Shifu and Roshin brought me in a little ways through the concept development to assist them with ecological design, more so than landscape architecture, but the two are one and the same for me. So can we go to the next slide? So this is just a quick snapshot of one of our more recent projects where we empowered all of the students at an elementary school to design their own edible ecosystem. So this is an example of us acting as ecological design facilitators as opposed to the almighty designers. So we were really just empowering these students to really take ownership and stewardship of this land. And this is a picture of the smudging ceremony that we performed with a First Nations lady. She comes from the Anishinaabe culture. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly. So this is us smudging the landscape, blessing the students and the landscape as this new ecosystem. So the Canoe Museum. What I really, really love and appreciate about Hennigan Penn's approach is they allowed the landscape to really inform the building. So it wasn't building put on the landscape, it was what's the landscape telling us, what's it doing, how can we integrate this building in a way that maximizes the usable land space. Because at the end of the day, that's what canoeing is about, is experiencing the outdoors. Right. So people visit the Canoe Museum to experience or explore the culture that surrounds the canoe and its people. So how do you create a landscape that celebrates that? And they've done that initially by creating the maximum outdoor space. If we go to the next slide, you know, Shifu mentioned, what if we were looking down from Google? I know Google's not like up there, but you wouldn't actually see this building. You would see the yellow brick road and wonder, well, I wonder where that goes. But you wouldn't really see the building. You would just see a landscape. Not the landscape. Many landscapes, but you can use it as a landscape. So what we hope to do, working with the architecture firm, is create more ecological identities within the different microclimates, the different pockets of this space. And I got to hand it to the previous firm for the birth girl approach. I've got it on my notes, I'm not stealing your stuff.
So we were actually hoping to put the birth girl. I'm not totally on it, I got it there. So here's our twist, though. Here's our twist. And our connection. So, Birch Grove outside, we probably have some cedar trees in here as well. I live in the forest, primarily.
Trembling
aspen. Trembling aspen. Cedar is significant for the cedar strip canoe. The birch bark is obviously significant for the birch bark canoe. Both are iconic Canadian symbols of the landscape. And what's more important for me is creating the tie between people and those trees. So yes, we make the news out of them, but we also can tap the birch trees and collect the sap and boil it down and make syrup. This is a mineral-rich sugar substance that could be used in the kitchen, which is right here.
Here on our scheme,
So people could actually experience those products being used and view how they're being used. Cedar tea is another one, very high in vitamin C. So we can use those elements, the way that the First Nations people, the way that the settlers may have used them, and actually create an educational piece and tie it into the building, and then take it out of the building again. So that's just one example. Can everyone hear me if I'm not? So there's a couple more examples, right? We've got this tree at the bottom here. I checked, it's actually a black walnut. So we could create polycultures of plants that would mimic natural Ontario ecosystems, right? So polyculture around walnuts and pawpaws and other fruit that would be native to the Carolinian or the Boreal forest, we can actually start celebrating those items and those foods within the building and actually create a product line around that would help with fundraising, more educational opportunities. Lastly, I'm probably running out of time. Lastly, the landscape as it's rendered is blank, right? Especially the roof is just this kind of lawn area right now. And we could have put a question mark there because we thought, let's make it a space, an outdoor space that we can use. But who are we to actually design that space and develop it? It's not us that's going to be using it. It's the users, the community, museum community, the Parks Canada community, local post-secondary institutes that study ecological restoration or indigenous environmental studies or farming could all be users of this space. So what we're really hoping to do is if we're so lucky with the opportunity, is really engage that community. And just like we did at that elementary school in Port Perry, you design it. I'll facilitate the design. I've got some framework and I have to stick within. I'll tell you what you can't do. But that's our hope, is let's create these ecosystems and these microclimates and these pockets. Let the landscape inform us, but let's do it together as a community, because you will be the stewards at the end of the day. So it should be you that's heavily involved in that design process. I think I'll pass it over to Rishi.
Last slide.
And this is the transformation from to a possible screen to one possible iteration of that roof. That's a transformation from a winter to a possible spring to one possible iteration of the roof. I just wanted to conclude, I suppose, to say there are three main drivers, our main points behind this project. One is containing the supremacy, it's the superlative quality of the lock. That the lock and the museum are actually come together and they seem together to make one space. So that the museum could only really exist in this place in relationship to this lock. The second is to maximize the relationship to the water. You can see there how the facade of the dependent weaves backwards and forwards, and the intention there is just to maximize the amount of frontage that you get to the water and also to create more inside-outside relationships. And the final thing is to give back to the community, if you like, the space of the museum by creating the space that the community can now once again inhabit. Thank you.
Basketball people here. That's great. So, questions? Do you have any questions from the floor?
How much land does that take? Is the city, is that, do you have to knock in a few houses down away to make a new concrete of a wall and a new concrete here? How much does that cost?
Okay, so the question is, how much land does that take?
Where is the access center?
There's actually a community garden existing right now towards the bottom of that slide, and we've actually ensured that we don't even encroach on that community garden, because that's one of the community partnerships that we would like to develop. So we're not knocking down any buildings, not even the gardens.
We're knocking down the existing visitor center. It's not very ecologically friendly. Let's put it that way. Yes.
I just wanted to say I appreciate how you both designed the internal museum.
question about polyculture and what does that really mean, and what does that mean for the community?
So the question is what is polyculture, and how does it relate to this particular design and scheme?
Sorry, sometimes I use words that I know what they are. So polyculture technically is any group of plants that has more than one species, so anything that's not a lawn, anything but that. But polyculture for me is an intelligently designed plant community. So you use natural ecosystems to kind of inform those relationships, and then you try to mimic those relationships so you can change plants as long as everyone in the community is kind of performing the same function, because that's how you create resilience, you know, perennial plant-based systems with no maintenance, minimal maintenance, really just harvesting at the end of the day.
Yes. Can you give us some idea of the interior spaces? And is the facade to the west, does it have windows that look out on the trees? And what is where?
What's where? Well, the...
The lot is north. That's west, and that's east.
So along the west side, is kind of built into the landscape. Start jumping, but so up at the top there is galleries, archive, and then down here is the kitchen. The entrance is along here. So as you can see, the site is sloping. The site is sloping. So as you come down to this point here, you're at the mid level of the building, so you enter in here, and then it continues down. So in answer to your question, yes, there are windows along the west side. But it's a much more solid site than on the west side, because we need to build a sustainable museum, but we also want to maximize views along the east, so we minimize the amount of windows along the west side.
That's also the side with the gallery and the archive.
And then coming up along here, so here is the kitchen, this is the event area, weddings, restaurant, this is the visitor center, the Parks Canada visitor center, workshops, and back up to galleries again at the top.
You don't have a slide that shows that, do you?
We don't have a plan.
Oh,
sorry. Not, we do have a plan, but... out here.
I believe there's an owner of the woods.
Yeah, it's on the board.
Yeah, we can
show
it on the board.
Also, if it's a question about natural light, that's where the Western window came from. I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, that kind of river you see down
the
road
is quit.
It's gone.
There we go. That's the river. So that's actually a window which will allow natural light through. So
So one more question.
What are the requirements will be programmable space for young children learning canoes and people experiencing the water? Where does that fit into the scheme that you've designed here?
Okay, so the question is talking about the programming, on water programming, and where is it located in this particular scheme? Understanding that I kept them this number of slides so that they don't panic.
There's a pond though.
Yeah?
There's a boat house. There's a separate boat house down on the water side. There's a boat
house.
Oh, it's out on the water's edge.
Yeah,
it's on the water side. It's
hard to see.
It's kind of
hidden
by some trees.
Yeah,
it's just there. So, it's just there.
I really appreciate you patronizing our gift shop. But here's a little something for you as well for the team. So, there we go.
everybody. And thank you very much for giving us such great imagery and design. The last firm for the evening is Bing Tong Associates, along with Bill Lett Associates, Bill Lett Architects. Is that correct?
Lett Architects,
sorry. So basically, we have Bing Tong, it's one of the leading firms in the country for architecture. They're based in Vancouver. Almost too many schemes to mention, you know, it's very retiring over there, but he's done a lot of great work in Canada. And Lett Architects have been in town here for what, 40 years?
Working
in Peterborough for some 40 years. And they've done a lot of the schemes that you know around town, including Market Hall and the recent Peterborough Archives, the new archive edition up on the hill, right near our site.
Cool.
So with no further ado, I'll introduce this gentleman. And take it away. Thank you.
Excuse us, we're just going to get into our... we know the last minutes of the evening, so it's like skit nuggets. Okay, so my name is Michael Eady, and I'm here with my colleague Bing Tong and our good friend Bill Lett, who Richard introduced with Lett Architects here in Peterborough. I should say that we're really delighted to be here. Usually when we're going to work on a cultural project, we tend to go to places like Hong Kong and New York and Washington, but it's actually really great being here because this is my hometown. This is where I grew up. I'm visiting my mom and my sister here, and I went to high school here. My dad worked at Trent, so we have deep roots in the city. And it's not just me. I have two colleagues, Peter Fortune and Giles Hall. I think some other family members are here tonight. So for us, this is really a meaningful project, and we're really absolutely delighted to be here. So when the sort of competition kicked off, the first thing we did was we got a group of us came from Vancouver Region, joined up with Bill, and we went to one of his projects, the Silver Bean Cafe, rented some canoes, and we went out and we thought we really have to understand this site from the water, for the canoes perspective of the site. So we rented these canoes and we paddled up to the lift lock, and actually went up and down the lift lock in the canoes, which was an absolute delight. And we started to really sort of think about the site, and we spent a lot of time with Bill and his team really understanding how this site fits into Peterborough, how it really makes sense to this community. And so on that note, I'm going to pass it over to Bill to start talking about the site.
The good thing about going last is you know you can pick up the mic if you want to walk around. So thanks for joining us. Whenever I give just a little anecdote, I had an excellent J stroke, and I'm so pleased that I can see Ken Sutherland here, who actually taught me how to canoe. So it's wonderful to have some familiar faces in the room. We also, interestingly enough, are currently working at Camp Candelore, which was the original site of the Canoe Museum on their master plan. So it's wonderful to be working with the original Canoe Museum and here to present this scheme. The site itself is one we know well. We are local. It's a site that if you're out there at noontime, you'll see many of the folks in our office running by. This is our run along the canal here and up past the wolf block and up to the museum. As Richard said, we did the museum project, and I see Susan Neal here, who's the executive director of the museum. And so we have a great run that we do in lunch times. And I think, you know, that has given us a sense of what the site is. And when we think about Peterborough and the geomorphology of this region, the St. Lawrence lowlands, and the drumlins that are so prominent in Peterborough, the fact that Trent University sits on the edge of a drumlin, this site too sits on the edge of a drumlin. So that was very important to us to use the drumlin as a starting point for our concept. Obviously, one of the main goals was to
really complement the lift lock and respect the lift lock. And so we're showing you our site plan, and by the way, we don't have plans either because we were limited to 7 slides, so if you want to see our plans, we've got them outside, but I'll try and do my best to describe it as we're being. So what we have is, the lift lock is here, north is up this way. What we were trying to do was pull our building away as it moved from the lift lock. So you can see the green roof of the building here, and also create an access that is a view corridor to the lift lock. And we've been referring to this space in the middle of our scheme as a knuckle. And the knuckle does a lot of different things. In this case, what we have are two wings of the building, if you will, that are prows. They're like prows of the community. And the knuckle is the circulation piece, the pragmatic piece that takes you to all aspects. And you can enter from both the canal side or from the parking lot side. And what's really interesting about this site is that it does not have a front, it does not have a back. And the architecture really needs to take advantage of that. And Bing will speak to some of that. But this is about creating a piece of sculpture in the landscape. And because we are on a drumlin, the intent, and there's been discussion about the functional program, was that we would put the gallery space, which we've been told should be a black box space, built into the side of the hill. So in fact, the building is only a few meters high at this point. And that is so that when you are approaching on Hunter Street, the view of the lift lock is still maintained in its current condition. The building gets bigger as it comes to the south, and also comes closer to the canal. And from the standpoint of approaching from Hunter Street is certainly vehicular, but as I said, we run across the canal. And one interesting piece is, if anybody's read the Little Lake Master Plan, that this is an important pedestrian route from the downtown and from the Silver Beam. We see this terrace space at the front of the building, we're calling this the front in some ways, as an important space. And when we think about what can happen in this space, we've talked about weddings, the wedding chapel, our multi-purpose spaces at this point, and we would want to engage with the water. So we see an opportunity here for this terrace to be used for weddings, for market activities, for sports events, for hockey events. We can fit an NHL rink very nicely in here. And really make this the community element of the building that has the relationship to the rest. We have very large terraces and stairs that bring you up to the upper level because we do have a slope condition that's occurring here, with restaurants and cafe spaces flooding out onto this element here, and the terrace wrapping around and coming to this side of the building. So really trying to create a landmark with respect to the lift block and the site itself. The other piece I should mention is that we did have a 30-meter setback that had to be maintained for sight lines on the canal. So something really interesting that, in fact, created some design opportunity for us as well. So I'm going to hand it over to Bing, and he can explain that in more detail.
Thank you. So I'm going to try to explain the project from the section. Remember what Bill mentioned was that the upper part of the building, there's a lift lock, so you come along on 100th Street. You can see the beginning of this building is virtually buried into the ground. That's the two-story exhibit hall that the program asked for. The centerpiece, the knuckle that he mentioned, is that you actually enter via a bridge. And on this bridge, right away, as you come open the front door, you see into the exhibit, into the story. So this building is really about traveling on land, but almost like you're on a canoe, because you are seeing a multiplicity of vistas as you travel through this building. But most importantly is directly when you go on this bridge, because the knuckle that we designed is on a diagonal, you will have the lock on access with your front door. So virtually, you're coming through the building, but your attention is to the lock. On this other side, we have the storage. So as I mentioned before, when you're on this bridge, you actually look into storage. And on the upper level, because the storage does not have to happen, extra high space. Because if you make the storage too high, you have trouble getting the canoes out. You can stack them 4 or 6 high, but if you get them 12 high, it's going to become very difficult. But on the other hand, all the administrative spaces are on this level. So if you come through the front door and you're going to administrative spaces, you just turn to the right. If you're going to the exhibits, you turn to the left. If you're going to the restaurant, you go directly ahead. If you're going to the multifunction room, the other kind of meeting rooms, you then take a sequence of stairs and you go down. But when you take that sequence of stairs, you go down, you actually walk through the storage area. So it's a way of asking you to come through the building. Now, when you come into the exhibit, you turn to your left, you get your tickets here. Once you get your ticket here, you're in a mezzanine and you overlook the exhibit space. You come through the exhibit space on a series of ramps, you come into it, and when you come out through the storage area. And Richard wanted to get some additional income, so we said, okay, you can put another cake here for another $10 or $5. it's a teaser. Otherwise, you can just stay and come back on top again. Or the program is designed so that working with the exhibitry, including Jeremy in the center here, we want to reverse the flow. You can actually come down the stair, you come in, you come up the ramp, you come back to the top. So the circulation path of these buildings, as you know, in all competitions, what you're seeing are sketch designs. We only had 8 weeks to do this. We're going to be together for the next 5 or 7 years. So it's going to take a little time to work up the details. The important thing is to try and get the idea clear. So this is a parking lot. You come through the parking lot, you come through the bridge, and on the bridge is where you're seeing into the storage area and you're seeing into the exhibit area. The gift shop is right there at the entry, and the restaurant is right here in front of you with a cafe, and the children play area is right here, and the lift lock is directly on the right, doesn't show. But the interior of the building, and the building is designed to be like an oyster, a very rough and rugged exterior and very soft and luminous interior. So we're bringing all the wood elements really into the interior finishes. And then the floor itself is just basically polished concrete because we're very aware of the price issue in terms of the budget. Because as you know, we always have to design the budget and we always have to design the schedules. But the exterior of the building itself, we wanted to pay respect to the lift lock. So the materiality of the building is very important. But before going to their detail, as you come through the knuckle, remember I mentioned you came through there, directly on your right is the park exhibit space. It gets really the best view to the lots because they have a relationship because it's Parks Canada. On this side is a restaurant, and the cafe, and the access now to the multifunction room is down below here with its pre-function area. It spills out directly into the canal. And then on this side, and enter the classrooms and the workshops that are related to the exhibitry. You can enter these two rooms also from the inside, and as you circulate from the inside, you also will look into storage as you enter into these functions. Now, the materiality itself, we first initially, of course, looked at wood, but I was a little bit worried because this structure is 100 years old. This structure is going to be 100, 150 years old. And we know what happens to wood over time, the operational cost, the maintenance issue. We looked at using stone, very good stone in the area, but the problem is, hand-making the stone, making the walls, it's a little bit more expensive. So we decided to use a contemporary version of stone, and that's concrete. So we have an idea here where, I've done this before in another building, where we're going to ask all the school children in schools to find a piece of scrap wood, and bring the scrap wood to school, and they can put whatever they want under that scrap wood, their signature, a poem, a message, whatever, and these pieces of scrap wood would form the formwork for pouring the concrete. And so when the concrete is poured out, all their messages are on the building. So they can tell their children and grandchildren, I helped build this building. This is truly a community building built by yourselves. The architects are actually just canoe designers or canoe builders, but you are the ones who are actually to make this. So my simple mathematics is that this was when this great structure was built 100 years ago, and everybody in Peterborough came out for the open. So that's the significance of a community building, that we design and we made, we create the initial image of this building, but in the end, you're all going to paddle it, because it's your canoe. And if you don't paddle it, it ain't going to go nowhere. So this building is, it's a lighthouse, it's a heart. It will glow in the evening, it will be a community center because we designed it. On your own. You don't necessarily require the museum hall to be open. But on the other hand, when you come into the museum, you see all the other functions that the building can offer. So, you know, this building and why we're interested is such an important story about Canada. The First Nations people welcome all of us here. They offer the canoe. The first spot canoe is unique in the world, doesn't exist anywhere else, and yet, canoe as a vehicle. I'm not an anthropologist, but other than walking on your feet, this was probably the first invention by human beings about travel. Probably on the law. And so this has endured all this time. And our next leader, who's volunteer with me, who actually looks at the visitor book, and gave me this quote. One visitor,
and they were from India,
and they said, what you have done here reinforces our desire to immigrate to Canada. So that's the message that you have here in your museum. In fact, this is the Noah Ark in the world. Canada is the biggest Noah Ark. All of us are here because we were all welcomed here by the First Nations people. So together, we will create the next icon for Peterborough, because you have a great law, you have a great university, you have good schools, now you can have a great museum. Thank you.
What questions do we have for Ming and his team? Yes, sir.
Earlier, you talked about water levels. Would it be possible or feasible to have a mini canal or a moat going right inside the museum and out, so people could actually move through the winter?
Yeah, that's the idea, was the water level and the idea of, you know, can we bring more water or some other opportunity for recreating on the water. So actually, if we can bring back the plan, we have just one idea where we actually, in this area where the seating is, you know, if we could convince Parks Canada to let us bring the building closer to the water, if not, if we can bring the water closer to the building. And so the one idea here is that if we could enlarge the canal to create a learning pond for the children to learn, and we probably could do it with 18 inches of water. And then when you have the wedding, we can drain the water and you can have the ice. And so there are many opportunities for that. But in the 8 weeks that we have to work, you know, these are just preliminary ideas. What you're really doing tonight is you have to decide which team you're going to fall in love with. Because we're going to have a long courtship of, you know, 5-7 years, and in the end we're all going to create a baby together. So it's like, tonight is like the Peterborough's Olympics, right? You've got all kinds of people from all over the world now. And so it's amazing, because I just, in my simple math, like, look, 300 people here, 80,000 people in Peterborough. I mean, to have for half of 1% of your population here on a weeknight, sitting through all of this stuff for 2-3 hours, that's amazing. I don't think any other community I've ever been in, you would have that. But one thing I would say, you're too many gray hairs. Own this, because if they don't own this,
huge to be carrying canoes down somewhere with concrete ramps.
We actually have the ramps. I mean, right there at the water's edge.
We built our ramps there, but the one
that is floating down. All these other ones is to bring people up into the buildings. And in fact, if we do get the green roof, the green roof itself, you can actually walk right up to the roof and come back to the roof. You can grow vegetables, you can go whatever for the restaurant. So the whole idea of the building is really part of the landscape. And you can see from even my other fellow competitors, this idea of integrating the building in the landscape is the most important thing we have. We have the only energy crisis we have in the world is really human energy. We're all getting lazy. And so if we start becoming more active, we start being supporting the earth, we support our cultural buildings the way we've done it, then in a way they will have a life on their own.
So any other questions we have?
Yeah, so the question is can the two parts of the museum, the exhibition and the storage area, operate independently from the multi-purpose rooms or a restaurant or cafe?
There's these ramps in there, from
the main lobby you come in, the exhibit and the entrance on your left, so if that was closed, you can just go straight ahead through the stair that brings you down to the multi-function room, or if somebody wanted to have a wedding in the storage area. Right? I mean, it could operate on its own. So the idea is to build this building in such a way it can operate on many, many levels. Because as Richard said, you know, cultural institutions are always struggling for ways to have multiple income. So that, but the best insurance for that is for it to be a building that you all love. In the end, you know, architecture has a lot of power because, you know, you look at the drawing and you look at the scheme, you're going to say, it's going to hit you in the heart, it doesn't hit you in the head. Right? In the end, that's the power of architecture. But in the end, the architecture is only as good as you bring it to life.
Yeah. Okay.
Tom and Bill Lett for their wonderful presentation, and I think that concludes our presentation segment of the evening, and I would like to say that we are bang on time, which is pretty good, so hopefully it's a good way to start a project, being bang on time, right? So hopefully you didn't save a budget. Now, the next segment is the architects are going to be by their boards. We have some easels, each group has some easels. Kenning and Peng is here, Contenders and Fox is here, they're still here. I know they had to run to another meeting. And basically, we gave our guests from the United States and Ireland this room. And out in the galleries are our three Canadian firms, 546 from Winnipeg, Big Tom, Vancouver, and Bill Lett together, as well as Provincial Roy from Montreal, and Nora from Kingston, Toronto area. And they're out there, and they're willing to take your questions. There's pads for you to write comments, and as well, please use your support token to indicate which scheme you would like to see built on the site. And I would like to thank you all very much for coming out and, you know, inviting your energy and input into these great designs. And we really appreciate your support, and we're really excited to have this potential here in Peterborough and offer a great community building for everybody. Thank you very much.